You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download.
And we'll play our footage through, and we'll cache it through. I'm going to click the play button here. And these playback tools are fairly standard. Now we're going to cache the shot. Okay, so it's playing through right now. And so one of the first things we need to do when we start a roto shot is do a shot analysis. A shot analysis is kind of like a shot approach plan. So I'm scrubbing through, I'm looking at my shot. I'm thinking about the instructions I was given for the roto that we need to do. So for this shot, for example, we need to isolate our foreground subject so that we can either replace the background or edit the background. So I'm looking at it play through, and I'm trying to think about how I'm going to create my roto shapes around my subject. And I'm thinking about how I'm going to hand off my work to the compositor or if I'm going to use it myself inside of Silhouette. So part of the process when you're doing your shot analysis is that you need to figure out if you need to do articulate mats or G mats or core mats. And so let's talk about those different kinds of mats. I'm going to zoom in here. I'm going to use the plus key on my keyboard and just pan over so that my subject is more in the middle of my screen. And I'll talk a little bit about the different kinds of mats, articulate mats or garbage mats or core mats. So an articulate mat is where you draw a shape around the edge of your object very tight. So it's right up against the edge. It's like you're articulating the edge of your object. So if I make this shape and then I just close it right here, this is just a little demo shape. So you can see I'm right on the edge. And we'll talk a little more about line placement in the future. So this is what is considered to be an articulate mat. It's right up against the edge. The next kind of mat we can talk about is a G mat. So I'm just going to turn off the visibility and we'll draw what a G mat would be. So a G mat stands for a garbage mat, and it could be used either to isolate what used to be called like the garbage outside of the shape or the garbage inside the shape. So that's what the term G mat comes from. So that would be considered a GMAT. And GMATs can be helpful with extractions and keying. So for example, if I wanted to try to key the outline of this hat and the glasses, but I didn't want anything else to interfere with that extraction, I could just draw a GMAT around my subject and perform my extraction inside. And one can also make a core mat. So a core mat would be a shape that's inside the object. And a reason to have a core mat would be, again, to help with extraction, to help fill in any holes. Or people use a lot of core mats when they are doing hair roto, and we'll cover that again in a later class. So now that we've covered mat types, we will go on to how to choose a spline type. Choosing a spline type is an important decision, and there are many factors to consider. If you are working solo, then it could be a personal preference. If you are working with a team, then most likely the type is already specified. Other factors that play a part in workflow decisions are if the splines will be exported in a format that have editing capabilities for the end user, and if the type you are rotoing in will end up being the same type if it will be exported to a different application. Silhouette has all three spline types, B-spline, X-spline, and Bezier, but not all other applications have all of them. If one is just exporting mat renders, then it might not make much of a difference, but from my experience, it's always good practice to have end-user editing capabilities. So here inside of Silhouette, we're going to experiment with some of the spline types. So I'm going to click the roto node here, and I'm going to click on the Bezier icon and start drawing a Bezier shape. So as I click and hold down, you can see that I have a control point and two tangent handles. And the longer I click and drag, the longer the handles are, and the larger the curve. And as we go in to close our shape, when we zoom in, I can click the plus key. And as I get close to the first point I put down, you can see a circle, and I click that and the shape is closed. And now we'll just do some simple editing. I can rotate the tangent handles by clicking on either one. And if I move one in, you can see it's sort of affecting the other side of the curve. If I hold down Control Command and I do the same, you can see that they are both moving the same amount in and out. And if I hold down the Alt key, I can just move one tangent handle at a time and create a corner. Another option is to select a control point and then right click. And you can see I have some options here with the pop-up menu, and I can make a corner that way. And another option with a Bezier shape, if I hold down the control command key and I click on a line in between the points, you can see I can edit the shape that way as well. So while I am not an expert in rotoing and Bezier spline type, it's because I didn't learn this way, but I still like to be fluent in all the spline types, because sometimes you'll get files with Beziers and you need to be able to know how to edit them. So it's always good practice, even if you are not rotoing in this all the time normally. So there is just a little example of the Bezier, and we'll move on to an X-spline. I'm just going to turn off the visibility of my Bezier shape here. I'm going to click S in the viewer, and I'm going to draw a shape with an X-spline. So you can see as I make my shape around the lens that there's a little green border, or it's called a tangent vector, around my line. And I can move my line by just clicking on those control points. There are no tangent handles. So now I'm going to go to the preferences, because inside of Silhouette, you can actually turn off these green lines, which are called the tangent vectors, and that's in preferences. File, preferences, and we'll go down to shape. We're already there, and I'm going to uncheck show tangent vectors. Apply, and when I go back to my shape, you can see that I have no green lines around my shape. So another thing to note is that you can also select a different spline type for your X spline. So we'll go back to preferences, and we'll choose an X spline point type of cardinal. So the default is B spline, but let's just see what the cardinal looks like. Apply and click OK. So when I make another shape, we'll just turn this off and we'll make a new X spline. Click the S for the hotkey. And now you can see that the point intersects the line. So it's more of a harder angle that we're looking at when we're creating our shapes, which could be not as easy to work with. So we're not going to really demo this type much more with the cardinal preference, and we'll go back to our other shape. So now we have our B spline that has the X spline with the B spline point type, and we'll just do a little bit more editing. So again, if I wanted to make this a point or a corner, I can click the Alt key, and as I drag, you can see that it changes the spline point tension. And that's, there we go, a corner. Or if I pull to the right, it makes it more of a B spline point type. And you can have different tensions with different points on the same shape. So if I click this, and I'll just pull this out so you can see it better, I can have a corner and a non-corner. I can also select a control point and click a corner there, makes a corner. And I can also alt click and change the tension. So if I hold down the alt key, you can see I'm changing from the corner to cardinal to the B-spline point tension. And the last spline type we will demo is the B-spline. So I'm just going to turn off my shape visibility and we will select the B-spline, which the hotkey is B, and then I can start drawing my shape. It's similar to the X-spline spline type. And then I can close my shape here. And it's the same editing capability keys that you have for the X-spline. If I select my control point here, I can click the Alt key, and if I drag, I have different types of tension. I can Alt click on a point, and that changes the tension as well. And I can also select a control point and right click and change the tension that way. So the functionality is basically the same. But what's different about X-splines and B-splines is that if I work in X-splines and I export them to certain programs, they get converted to a Bezier spline. And that might not be something that you want. And once something is a Bezier spline, it's always a Bezier spline. There's no converting it back to a B-spline or an X-spline. But with certain programs, if I work in B-spline, then when I export it, I have the option to have a B-spline. So again, there's many factors to consider, and the biggest thing is if you want end user editability, and if you're exporting or importing, what's going to happen to those shape types.